sun shining with glory all over the world. He is our glory as we walk through the day. He is our fire through the night. Oh, he's our shining, a shining. We can see. Prevail again, his kingdom has come with great light. Those who dwelt in the land of deep darkness, on them as light shone. His light is shining, it's shining. We can see it shining, shining. Light of the world is shining, it's shining. We can see him shining.
When I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I am never alone. You are a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. When I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say your word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Can hardly speak. It's peace.
you for the way that you draw us close. Thank you for your perfect love that casts out all fear. You are perfect in all of your ways.
Hello everyone, welcome to church. We are so glad that you are here. Ek gaan vir ons vanoggend 'n bietjie lekker Engels praat van ons mense wat na hierdie dienste van ons luister wat nie Afrikaans verstaan nie. So it's so nice having everyone online enjoying this service with us. We've got a special topic this morning. You can write it down somewhere on your notepad or your phone, if you're making notes, hopefully you are, between all the kids running around and everything's crazy at home. Spirit-filled Jesus. Spirit-filled Jesus. I don't know who of you in this time needs support of some kind, or needs some comfort, or needs some help, or need to act on truth or know truth. I don't know who of you maybe need some extra power because you've used everything in your own life. I sure need some extra supernatural power. Some of us need hope because we're hopeless. Everyone's getting sick, and the situation in our country can minister to us. So we need hope, we need faith, we need power, we need love, we need joy more than anything. We need support, we need comfort, we need help. And what I'm describing to you is the ministry of the Holy Spirit. I was thinking about the ministry of the Holy Spirit this week and thinking how many times we actually forget about the ministry of the Holy Spirit. Because, you know, the Holy Spirit never draws attention to Himself. He always points us to Jesus. But as we see Jesus, it's the Holy Spirit that opens our eyes so that we can see Him. And so we tend to sometimes forget about the precious Holy Spirit, that He is precious, that He is faithful, that He is worthy of our time, of us thinking and speaking about Him. Scripture says that He can be grieved, that He is a person, He can be grieved. That we can act in a way which resists Him. And this morning I want us just to look at the works of the Holy Spirit in the life of Jesus. And what I want to make a statement, and then we're going to unpack that. And the statement is if Jesus needed the ministry of the Holy Spirit, the work of the Holy Spirit in His life, I promise you we need it as well. We need it even more. If someone who is fully God and fully man still need the empowerment of the Holy Spirit, the leading of the Holy Spirit, being filled by the Spirit, being born of the Spirit, being sustained by the Spirit. If He needed that, we need that as well. And I think in this time we're so focused on we can be focused on everything that's going on in this crazy world that we forget that we can tap into the work of the Holy Spirit and allow Him to come and work in us, to fill us, to lead us, to empower us, to sustain us, to live a supernatural life. I think more than ever, it's necessary for the church to be different, to live a supernatural life, to be empowered as believers, to be filled with hope and joy and love and peace. That's needed more than ever. So we're going to start by the first work of the Holy Spirit. It said in Matthew 1:18 that Jesus was born of the Spirit. Okay? Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When His mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, they were engaged. Before they came together, met ander woorde, hulle het nog nie seks gehad nie, vir al die jonger mense wat nie dit verstaan nie. Before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. She was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit birthed Jesus inside of Mary. He planted the seed and Jesus was born by the Holy Spirit. Jesus was born by the Holy Spirit. Now, I don't know if you can remember the time when you were born of the Spirit. I remember it as a time where my soul was filled with the love of God. I was aware of His presence. I was fully alive to Him. You know, and that's my prayer for us as a church, is that we will be people that's fully alive to God. That's not dead in our sins anymore. That's fully alive to Him. And we can be at a place where our light is really dim, where we're not fully alive. We're not really alive. We're barely hanging in there. We're surviving, but we're not fully alive, filled with joy and peace like those first days when we just came to meet Jesus. I remember driving around in my car and being so aware of His presence from listening worship music that I copy pirated from other people. I've repented, don't worry. I was so aware of His presence. I was fully alive to Him. I was born of the Spirit. Ephesians 5 says that it's by grace through faith that we are saved. So it's us by faith crying out and saying, Lord, we're so tired. We need a Savior, a healer. We're tired of religion. We want to have a living relationship with You. And then by grace, He saves us. He does a miracle on the inside of us, and because it's sort of hidden on the inside, we can see the fruit of it. We can see the fruit of it when there's a softness of heart, when there's true repentance, when people get baptized, it's that they publicly declare the faith that listen, something happened on the inside, I was born again. And that's why Jesus said to Nicodemus, you need to be born again, you need to be born by the Spirit. It's a miracle, it's an act of God that He comes to revive our spirits, to make it alive. It's dead from birth. We're not saved, and I know some of us, we know this, but we're not saved automatically. They need to be a born again. We need to be born by the Spirit. Supernatural act, becoming alive unto God. Knowing Him, feeling His presence, becoming aware of Him. It's truly a miracle. And so there's three dimensions to our relationship with the Holy Spirit. The first one is that the Holy Spirit is with us, that the Holy Spirit is in us, and the Holy Spirit is upon us. So I love this statement that I read this week. It says that the Holy Spirit is with us for salvation. He's all around us. He's omnipresent. God is omnipresent by His Spirit on earth. He's everywhere by His Spirit. Everywhere. He's here now. He's also in Malmesbury, also in Wellington, also in Stellenbosch, also in Turkey, also in Saudi Arabia. Everywhere. He's everywhere. He's with us for salvation, drawing us unto Christ, drawing us all the time, just convicting us of our sins, of our unrighteousness, of judgment coming, convicting us, turning us to Jesus. And then He comes to the Holy Spirit is in us for sanctification. He comes to live in us. If we're born by the Spirit of Christ lives inside of us. And we're born by the Spirit, and He sanctifies us. He speaks to us. He says, no, don't do that. Don't do that. Leave that. Stop that. Repent of that. Yes, say yes to this. He leads us to become like Christ, to be sanctified in our walk. And then He rests upon us for our service. So He's with us for salvation. He's in us for sanctification, and He's upon us for our service. He equips us. He sends us out. He commissions us and says, He says, go into the world and go and preach the gospel. Heal the sick. Go and do these things as you've seen it done by Jesus, which is empowered by the Holy Spirit. So Jesus is born of the Spirit, okay? And then Scripture says that He's filled with the Spirit. Matthew 3:16, you've all read this. It says, when He had been baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to Him. And He saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and resting upon Him. The Spirit of God rested upon Him. He was baptized by the Holy Spirit. Okay? So then He lived a life of prayer where He was continually filled with the Spirit. We need to be filled with the Spirit. I want to read you a command that Paul wrote in Ephesians 5:18. It says, do not be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit. Now that command through Paul to be filled with the Holy Spirit, I think it's vital. The Greek word for filled is pleroo. It means to fill and disperse throughout one's soul. Even more important, is the tense of the verb, okay? This is what it means. It means to be filled throughout one's soul, but this is the tense in which it's written. The verb is written. It's a passive, imperative, present tense. For all the tall junkies, the language junkies, they will be very excited now. It's a passive, imperative, present tense. The passive voice implies that you, the subject, are to be acted upon. If you want to be filled, you need to act upon it. It's not going to be something spontaneous. You need to act upon it. You need to step out, okay? So, you need to act. The imperative voice makes it a command, not a suggestion. And the present tense aspect implies continuous action. So, if we need to be filled with the Holy Spirit, like Paul wrote in Ephesians 5:18, it says that we need to act upon it. We need to act upon it daily. We need to be full continuously, continuously. It's something that we do. We fill ourselves. If you are empty of the Holy Spirit, if you can be filled, you can be empty. If you're empty, it's not the fault of the Holy Spirit. It's your fault. I love you, but it's your fault. You need to be full. That's why we do the prayer room. That's why we do worship. That's why we do these things. It's to be filled. It's not to get goosebumps. It's to be filled. It's to be filled so that when we filled, that we go out. And have you seen Ephesians 5? It compares someone filled with the Spirit to a drunk person. Have you seen drunk people? Okay, don't answer that in your living room. Just silently nod to your wife. I've seen them, and maybe at one stage I've been them. If you're filled with wine, you are bold. You say whatever. Whenever you want to know what someone thinks, just fill them with wine. Don't do this, believers. Don't fill them with wine. But you know that then they say their religious opinion, political opinion, their opinion of you, of your friends, of your wife, of everyone. Okay? So they're filled with boldness. But how do you get drunk with wine? You need to drink. And it's exactly the same. How do you get filled with the Spirit? You need to position yourselves in prayer and worship, spending time with Jesus, saying, Lord, I'm taking time out. It's not going to happen, guys, if we spend 10 minutes reading a Bible app. It's not going to happen. You're not going to be filled. You're not going to be changed. You're not going to experience the power of the Spirit, the joy of the Spirit, the peace, the righteousness, the desire for holiness. Those things will not be in your life if you are not being filled continuously by the Spirit. Okay? Be filled by the Spirit. Be filled by the Spirit. It's a command. It's a command. It gives us boldness. If Jesus needed it, we need it. If Jesus needed it, we need to be empowered by the Spirit. Okay? And that's why it's so exciting for me to be in the valley and to just hear the stories of what God has been speaking to us as a church. And one of those stories is Genesis 26:18, where there's a command to redig the wells of the fathers, okay? To redig the wells. Now, in Old Testament context, a well is something that gives water and life. But John 7, New Testament says that when we're filled with the Spirit, it's like a river of living water coming forth from our innermost being. And a well in the New Testament context is when God has done something that He's filling people. People are being born by the Spirit. Something supernatural, an outpouring of the Holy Spirit happens in a certain place. And when we as a church got that command where the Lord said, I'm giving you a second chance to redig the wells in this valley. There was a well with Andrew Murray and the revival spread over the mountain and it impacted our nation. There was every 5 years a revival in the school where people are revived. They are being filled with the Spirit. They're born of the Spirit. They're being led by the Spirit. Okay? And that we can be a part of it. So I want to make it really practical for us. How are we a part of redigging the wells? Okay? Ons moet ons graaf optel. Hoe tel ons graaf of hoe raak ons deel van hierdie ek is besig om hierdie hierdie fontein oop te grawe, fontein van lewe. What do we do? I think first of all, we come together as a family. We leave the disunity, the opinions, the whatever we have, and we gather as a community and say, listen, we're a family. We believe this is what God is saying to us, and we are going for it. We're running as a family all together, running in this direction. It's not one or two or three people. It's everyone together running in this direction. We want to see revival. We want to see a church revived and fully alive to God and awake to God, filled with His Spirit, to the overflow, filled with joy and peace and righteousness. And I know as I'm saying these things, you're saying in your heart, yes, but it's going to cost us something. It's going to cost us maybe to stand up early. And I know everyone can't be in the prayer room. It's early in the mornings when kids need to go to school. But when we have a big group and we worship together, be sure to be there. When we do a Thursday night or a Sunday night in the future, be sure to be there. Why? Because you need to be filled with the Spirit. You need to be filled with the Spirit. Okay? So how do we come together as a family? Okay? We're in unity with regards to this. We join the events. We join the worship. We join the prayer. We join on Sunday mornings. We join small group. And one of the reasons, or one of the ways in which you can dig as well is by giving. Because everyone can't be there. Everyone can't do the work. Everyone can't minister in the schools. I know that you guys are busy and there's a lot of things happen. But there is people that can do it. But we need to provide for them. And you've seen the fundraising updates. Thank you for everyone that's been giving. We love it, and I think that if everyone in this church sacrifices a bit and sow into this, you don't have to sacrifice, something that's a lot and you feel, listen, I won't be able to do this. Just take a step of faith. Just take a step of faith. Say, listen, I'm going to sow into this per month for the next 2 years because I want to be a part of it. I promise you, when we as a church gather and do that and everyone sacrifice to take this forward, I believe it's going to be a big step for us as a church in faith. And we've been speaking about this, sowing seeds in faith. This is sowing a seed in faith. We're sowing a seed in faith. We're taking a step collectively. And when people are being born of the Spirit in our midst and we are being filled by the Spirit on Sunday, then we're going to remember these times when we haven't seen it yet, but we've sown. We've sown to that. We've as a church sown to that. We've come together and say, this is what God is saying. I'm going to sow into that. And I believe for a revival. I believe for a church that's fully awake. I believe for revival amongst the youth. And I believe for people in the prayer room to encounter God and God to encounter them. That's what we believe for together as a church. Okay? Be filled with the Spirit. The third thing and last thing says that Jesus was led by the Spirit. Matthew 4:1 says Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. To be tempted by the devil. So just the progression is interesting. We first filled and then we're being led. So some of us, we're seeking for direction from the Lord, seeking for His leading. The focus shouldn't be His leading. The focus should be to fill yourself. Because when you're filled, you will be led. You will hear the voice of the Spirit as He nudges you to go this way and that way and saying, no, don't do that. Yes, do this. Say yes for this. Say no to this. He will slightly, gently guide you and lead you. But you need to be filled. Don't look for His hand, okay? Look for being filled. Ask for being filled. Say, Lord, fill me with Your Spirit. I wanna surround myself with people that wanna be filled, that people that's already filled and that's helping to lead me, to lead this church, to lead this movement of people that's fully awake and fully alive unto God. It's something that happens naturally as we are filled by the Spirit. Okay, Romans 8 says, it's interesting, it says that being led by the Spirit is a mark of sonship. Being led by the Holy Spirit is the mark of sonship. It says, Romans 8:14, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are sons of God. Guys, this is our inheritance as a people of God, as His sons, as His daughters. We can be led. We don't have to be people running around in the dark, not knowing what's God's will for my family, my business, my life, my everyday. We can be a people that's led by Him, that do supernatural radical things, not because we're trying to be supernatural or radical, but because we're taking small steps of saying, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, and it leads us into a certain direction. It's interesting that the way he leads us, the way he led Jesus was into the wilderness. And sometimes the way he leads us is not comfortable to our flesh. In fact, in every single way, the way he will lead you is that it will destroy your flesh. He will lead you to fast. He will lead you to pray. He will lead you to give. He will lead you to act in mercy. He will lead you to extend forgiveness. He will lead you to be merciful. That's how he leads us, because he's leading us to become more like Christ. It's not to what we do, it's to who we become. We become like him. We're being led to be like Christ, to become like him. And he leads us gently. He doesn't drive us. He leads us. He leads us. So I want to pray for us that we will be Spirit-empowered people, like Jesus being filled with the Spirit, that we will be filled with the Spirit. We'll be born of the Spirit, filled by the Spirit, and led by the Holy Spirit. Next week, we're going to speak about being sustained by the Spirit and empowered by the Spirit. Okay, but let's be a people that's fully aware of the ministry of the Holy Spirit, that it's important to us, and that He will sustain us and give us joy and peace. So Lord, right now in Jesus' name, as we're watching this video, Lord, we pray that you will fill us in our living rooms, in our offices, wherever we are. Come and fill us, Holy Spirit. We just give ourselves to you. We say we want to be fully alive, fully awake to you. And we bless you in Jesus' name. Thank you for you, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, we honor you. We bless you. We thank you. Thank you for leading us into truth, comforting us, helping us, supporting us, empowering us. We are a people that's filled with you. Come and fill us today again. Come and fill us today again in the name of Jesus. Bless you guys. Thank you for listening. We see you next week. Bless you. Bye-bye.